good morning, everybody. Nice to see everyone. Apologies for the late start. We were told that we had a couple more minutes, and so we were waiting for you, and it turns out you were waiting for us. So thanks for being here. It's good to see very many familiar faces in the room today. My name is Josh Nisbet. I work with Deloitte here in Sacramento, and we're thrilled to be one of the sponsors to today's events and to provide some thinking and some thoughts around exponentials and disruptive technology. I know that we're in good company with the people and organizations that are presenting and facilitating discussions at today's event. So our next about hour and 40 minutes together is going to be interactive. So we're thrilled that you're here. We hope that you've brought some good thoughts with you and some experiences from your own organization, from things that you've witnessed in the industry and around government, and because we're going to use some of that. And we're going to ask you to work with some of the neighbors that you're sitting next to participate with us as we really walk through what we would like to call a three-act play. So in today's first act, we have an objective, and that is to blow your minds. That's a big objective. But what we want to do is expose you to perhaps some things that you've already seen, but give us an opportunity to explore mind-blowing innovation, which is not happening a decade from now, or 5 years from now, or even a year from now, but it's happening today. It's all around us. We're going to share with you some of the innovations both in technology as well as service delivery in commercial sector, in government sector, all around the world, and give you an opportunity to freak out a little bit at what's happening around us. It's pretty exciting stuff. Once we've blown your minds, we hope to move into Act Two. And that is to say, okay, so there's some pretty phenomenal innovation going on. There's disruptive technology happening all around us. But what does that mean in the government setting? What does that mean to government service delivery and the business of delivering the services that you and I as citizens need across the state, across the country, and across the globe? Now, as we do that, we'll move into Act Three. And Act Three is really where the rubber meets the road. Because that is the, what does this mean to me in my job? What does this mean to you in your job? As you deliver services, as you work within your organizations, your agencies, how can this disruptive technology, this innovation that is happening all around us, change the way you approach what you do? How can the services be streamlined? How can they be altered to meet you and I, the citizen, where we need them to be? We're going to prioritize some of the innovations that we talk about. We're going to decide maybe which ones are potentially the most relevant to you and your jobs, and hopefully leave you with some things that you can take back to your organization in terms of the way that you lead, the way that you work, and the technology and services that you provide. So we're really thrilled that you're with us today. We hope, again, I just want to stress that you don't mind speaking up. There's going to be some opportunity to interact with each other, with us, to get your thoughts and to share thoughts with each other. We're thrilled for that opportunity. We feel that we've got a point of view to share with you, and so we're really glad that you'll invest that time with us for the next, like I said, about hour and 40 minutes or so. I want to introduce you to our two esteemed guests, two gentlemen who will be leading us through this discussion today. Our first is Balaji Bandili. He will be the one that comes up for Act One. He's got the daunting job today to blow your minds. So let him blow your minds. What is it?
No pressure.
No pressure. Let me tell you a little bit about him. He works within our Deloitte Consulting Innovation practice. He manages two of our product business lines, and both of these product business lines focus on innovation and disruption in service delivery. One of them is a product that basically, and he'll do a better job of introducing this, but I want to kind of tell you in my terms. He takes that gap between banks and financial organizations and institutions that are ready to invest and the technology firms within the financial sector who have, you know, that startup feel to them, and brings capital and investment together with new innovative ideas. I think a great prerequisite to share what some of the things he's going to talk to us about today. The other amazing space that he plays in is around crowdsourcing. Now, we talk about crowdsourcing even here at the state of California, and we mention it as an important advancement in development of new ideas and technologies. And typically, unfortunately, what happens is the crowdsourcing happens in fits and starts, in pockets and packets here and there. And Balaji is working in a space that, from a holistic enterprise view, begins to organize crowdsourcing in such a way that it makes a higher impact with less cost in a structured, organized way, so that it all works together as opposed to rifle shots here and there. He'll probably come up and tell you that I've done a completely horrible job of describing what it is he does, but from what I understand, those are two very interesting ideas that he works with. He's a Bay Area guy, by the way. Recent transplant, but we'll call him a California native, at least as a recent transplant. After Balaji blows your minds, Bill Eggers is gonna come talk to you. He's sitting on the front row as well. Some of you might remember Bill because he's keynoted this conference before. So we've already learned in a macro way a lot from Bill. And today he gets to be with us in this intimate setting. Let me tell you a little bit about Bill. I'm gonna read a little bit of it because it's pretty impressive. He's responsible for our research and thought leadership within Deloitte's public sector industry practice. So when we as an organization wanna know where government's going and we wanna skate to where the puck is gonna be, so to speak, we go talk to Bill. He's the author of 8 books. You know, some of us haven't even read 8 books. Including his newest book, co-authored with Paul McMillan, The Solution Revolution, How Business, Government, and Social Enterprises Are Teaming Up to Solve Society's Biggest Problems. I believe that, frankly, some of the leaders within the state of California government were interviewed as a part of the research for this book, and some of the others that he's done. This book, which the Wall Street Journal calls, quote, you ready? Pulsating with new ideas. They use the word. About civic and business and philanthropic engagement, was named to the 10 best books of the year list by Wall Street Journal. His earlier books, probably some of you have read, include the Washington Post bestseller, If We Can Put a Man on the Moon. I've given some of you that book as a gift, by the way, so I hope you've read it. He's won numerous awards, including the best books on policy, leadership, and public services from The Guardian, and the 2014 Axiom Book Award for Best Book on Business Theory. Many other accolades. One of my favorite things is that Bill actually documented, coined the term government 2.0. So he's been thinking about this space for a long, long time. His commentary appears in dozens of news media outlets all of the time. I could go on and on. But these are the two gentlemen that we're having an opportunity to talk to and be with today. I will get out of the way of my two guests and turn the time over to Balaji. Sir.
Thank you. You know, it's interesting when Josh talks about blowing your mind. And I think the point of view is not necessarily about, you know, is there something completely new that is happening in the marketplace that I'm going to talk right now that you've never heard before, that you've never seen before. Actually, it's untrue. In many ways, this presentation is more about what you're seeing around that is happening already to you, things that you already use, but put it in a context of what are the underlying factors that are driving it there. So whenever you see anything new, you are forced to ask the question, what's driving that? And whatever is driving that, can I use that to make my job better or make my agency's operations better or the way we serve our citizens better? So it's converting what you see out in the marketplace, putting a structure or a layer of you know, technology to understand, to make a little bit of a sense of what we see going on right now. You know, the two big words that I've already used are exponentials and disruption. You know, we'll peel a layer off these two big terms and give you examples and have a real conversation about what do those really mean and how do they impact lives of all of us, and as a result, the large companies, the startups, and the government. And I think this is where majority of it will come to bear. Let's do a quick exercise. You know, there are a bunch of companies there on the screen right now.
Let's have a show of hands to see how many of you have used at least one of them in the last 6 months. At least one of them. Okay. How many of you have not used any of them? Don't raise your hand, clearly. But I think what you realize is things like right now, things like Uber, things like our iPhone, things like Airbnb and Netflix, and maybe Netflix and chill, these are things that are so common right now that you don't even reflect on that these are technologies that didn't exist even 2 or 3 years back. Majority of us started thinking about Uber or, you know, even, you know, iPhones. iPhones are 6 years old. They haven't been here since beginning of time. That they almost feel like they are so indispensable that how did people live before the iPhones? How did people, sit on trains and...
You keep talking. I'm just going to plug this on for you.
Sure.
I'm going to free up your hand there, brother. I'm going to put this in your pocket?
I'll take it. How do people, you know, ride on trains and wait on a crossing? What did they do? What did they do with their hands? They always have a phone right now, without even a second thought. And again, think about Uber or Airbnb. Airbnb is right now more valuable as a company than the Starwood Group or the Hilton Group combined, because they're growing faster. Because the amount of time it takes Starwood Group or Westin or Hilton to come up with 100 rooms, Airbnb at the same time comes up with 100,000 rooms. So this is, of course, changing the way our cities think about growth, our cities think about who citizens are and who service providers are. And of course, as you can see, even in the front page of New York Times, you can see all of these sharing economy services and how they're pushing back at regulations, at government, at how people think about who is a provider and who's a real consumer. My glasses are Warby Parker. They're $100, where usually typically you take a prescription and you go choose a frame and it takes $400 or $500 to make stuff like that. And now I get 5 of them for free at home, and if I don't like any of them, I can wear all of them and just return it back. So it's the amount of customer service that is coming up that is driving all of these. And what is structural about all of these as to why is Uber so popular? And why are people using it so much? Because it's the underlying exponentials that enable a company like an Uber or a company like Apple or Amazon to move extremely fast. I'll give you a quick example. Maybe two examples, one which is a good example, another one is a bad example. I'm not sure if Sacramento Uber pool exists, where multiple people can take the same ride, same car, if they're all going in the same direction. Uber decided we're gonna test it out. We're gonna test a new concept, where instead of multiple people from same location going to a different similar area, we'll take one long ride and multiple short rides. And typically for this decision to be made for a large company that affects 1 million rides a day, you take a lot of time to research that. What would Uber do? Uber would say, we're gonna try it. So they built that little feature on the app in about a week, is what I hear, and then tried it out for one day. And when you're within the ride, it pops up on your screen to say, are you happy with this ride or not? Thumbs up, thumbs down. So they get instant feedback on what something is working versus not. The cycle time of decisions in exponential era is almost in minutes and seconds and days versus months and years when you were not. And I think that's the biggest expectation of consumers right now from all service providers, whether they're large companies or governments, that they react really fast to what they're thinking, what they're hoping, and what they're expecting. And that's the power of exponentials from a consumer's perspective or from a citizen's perspective. And what's driving all of that? That's primarily driven by a technology paradigm that the calculations per second are accelerating every couple of years. So for example, right now, the amount of power in your cell phone was more than a satellite a decade back. Next year, as of now, today, with Watson, and we'll go through a few examples when Bill comes on, there's more computing power in Watson than humans, than a human brain. It's also said that by 2050, within a chip, there'll be enough computing power that is equivalent to all of the human brains around the world. Now think about your ability to process, ability to make decisions, ability to analyze things that people do at a human pace, and now machines are doing it at a machine pace. What are the kinds of things that you'd be able to do? Let's take a couple of examples and walk that through. What is exponential? Linear is if I've walked from here to there, about 30 yards, you maybe cross the length of some part of the length of a football field. But if you take 30 exponential steps, you actually circumnavigate the world, which is every step you're multiplying what's happening. And that's how computing power is growing. And you see a few examples, which is right in your hand, just as a digital photography. You know, when you see black and white movies, you see this big camera on stilts, on stands, with a guy with a black blanket behind taking a picture. And we all used our digital cameras over a period of time. And of course, all of us had one. Now these days, when I go on a vacation, I usually don't even carry a big camera with a backpack, because my iPhone does a fabulous job of taking most pictures. Of course, you still have people who want to be professionals, all of them tourists carrying a Canon camera with a big lens that they usually don't do anything with. It's just become a thing that you...
You probably just offended somebody.
No, I actually offended myself, because I have a bunch of those big cameras that I just shoot, but nobody really uses them. But what is really used are the pictures that you shoot on your phone, because you quickly share them, and people are commenting on them, people are liking them. And that's not really an ability that a digital camera was able to give you. But then right now, the quality of the pictures coming out of your camera are so good that you don't need all the stuff anymore. And how is it possible for a thing to be that small and that strong? The types of things that went into creating that camera that powerful, into creating that screen that looks that good, if for it to process data so quickly and take a picture for you, and you can manipulate it that quickly in that little piece where earlier you needed a big ass computer to like do the manipulation, and now you can do all of it on your phone. I think that's where the market is changing, that's where the world is going. And now, all of those little things that we used to use in the past, 5 years back, or even 4 years back, or even last year, smartphone has taken over all of them. Somebody actually did a calculation about 15 years back, the number of devices that were used because smartphone didn't exist, you needed $1 million to buy all of them. Right now, you spend close to nothing if you have a plan to get a cell phone. And these are the examples where technologies come together, converge together, and give you a product that is so easy to use, that is so close to consumers, whereas high-tech science in the past was always the bastion of large companies, large labs, NASA type of agencies. And now the most advanced technology succeeds when it gets close to people, really, really close to people, and where people can actually contribute to improving it, to trying it, to experimenting with it. And I think that's where exponentials bring. Exponentials are not the coolest nano material that is happening that'll change a huge thing in the world, which does exist. But exponentials actually brings all of that science close to people. That makes you can actually touch and feel these exponentials, and you know things like we'll show you a few examples of how Facebook uses a significant amount of intelligence for it to do what it does right now, but it does it in a way that is so easy for you to use. You know, Facebook has Facebook's handbook, the one thing that it says, which is one of my favorite quotes ever, is people come to Facebook not because they love Facebook or the technology or the investments that we've made. They come to Facebook because they like their friends and to spy on friends. That's basically what people come to Facebook for. And the easier we make it for them, the more they come to us. And the making it easy part is where analytics, is where picture recognition, is where server technology, is where cell phone interaction, all of them come together. When the engagement with consumers and citizens that's when the rubber meets the road, just as an example. You know, and let's take a look at what has happened in the past, and let's look at what's happening in the future. You know, over a period of time in the past, there were computers the size of this room. And then it went to computers, smaller computers, and then computers started getting connected with each other. And then people, you know, the technology engagement in the 2000s when Netscape and all of that, when people, individuals that are not scientists, started interacting with computers, and I think that started changing the revolution. And now you have mobile phones, which becomes all about data. And now is the time when all of that technology is coming to fruition and it's taking off. You see conversations around driverless cars. Just as a concept that is freaky, fascinating, and also something that I don't like because I like to drive my cars. So I don't like to sit behind and read a newspaper. But the fact that you can do that, and the fact that I come from Manhattan and my fiance has never been behind the wheel of a car, and neither should she ever be. And for her, an ability to move around and have the option to see the world without, you know, just by having a driverless car, and the impact on insurance, the impact on safety, when that comes to fruition, and the corresponding impact on regulation, and how do you think about it? I mean, if the driverless car, by mistake, it's never happened as yet, crashes into someone, who's responsible? Is the guy who owns the car responsible? Google is responsible because they're making it? Nobody knows right now, and these are the open questions technology is creating for all of us. Digital money. I'm not sure if any of your children or you by yourself use any of the new digital money applications that are coming up, like Venmo. Have you anybody heard of Venmo? So you should ask your kids, how many of you use Venmo? That is the most popular banking application right now in the millennials. When they go to a movie or they go for dinner, somebody picks up the check and they quickly transfer money on their phone to each other. It takes less than 2 seconds for the money to get into your phone, and then it takes another couple of hours for it to get into your bank. It was interesting. I'm going to give this back to Bill a little bit. There was a interview done by at Davos at World Economic Forum between the CEO of MasterCard and CEO of a company called TransferWise, which is an international remittance company. So the interviewer asked the question of TransferWise, saying, you know, how are you able to do this so easily that you can transfer, let's say, $10,000 from UK to India at like 10 cents or a dollar, whereas MasterCard, you know, it takes MasterCard, you know, $100 to do it. They said the question is not, you shouldn't be asking me that question. You should be asking MasterCard that question as to why do they charge 5%, you know, even if IMF sends aid to a country, one of the intermediaries takes 5% of that. Whereas the actual act of moving money across borders or between people is as simple as sending an email. There is no more computing power required. There are no more infrastructure required. It's moving bits and bytes. And now all of these startups that sit in that frame are all moving bytes and bits differently, faster, cheaper, and that's what is driving the convergence. And if you look at the driverless car, it's as much a software as it is a car. It's actually a lot more software than the box that it comes in. So, and when you talk about software, it's all about bits and bytes. So the world is changing more based on the data and the digital applications that are coming out versus, you know, let's create more cup holders in a car, which is what, frankly, a lot of car companies sold their products as. So let's look at a few exponential domains. Now, I'm not going to go through all of them. And Bill has an exercise a little later where we'll come together and have a more conversation about this. Artificial intelligence, we had a quick discussion about it. Advanced robotics. If anybody has not been to a Lowe's store recently, they actually have a robot that will greet you when you walk in and asks you a question. So, and you can say, I want to find this kind of a nut. You can actually show it, put it up in the hand, it'll scan it, and then it'll say, okay, now follow me, I'll take you to where it is. Or you can ask a question to say, this is what I'm looking for, and it'll say, okay, I'll take you to where it is. Completely by itself, there's no human sitting inside that is kind of like using a little stick to take you there. Augmented reality, if you have time in the evening when you're watching TV, you should look at, let's say, a demo of a company called Magic Leap. It's a new company that is coming out that's in Miami that just got valued at $7 billion without having a product in the market, because it's expected to change the way the world sees the world, where we see the world, that you can just sit here and imagine the world in front of you, a completely different way to see, just a completely different way to see what's happening. And it's a very, very interesting company. Even if you just go see a demo of what they're working on, it'll just blow your mind, literally. And that's not in the market right now, but soon it will be. Sharing economy, we've spoken about Airbnb and Uber and all of these, where instead of building constantly, using existing capacity, existing availability of assets, and reusing them much better, better for the environment, better for people, and gives more authentic experiences to people versus, you know, constantly having a commercial conversation. Again, I'm not going through all of them, but these are technology on one side and business models on the other side. Convergence of these two is creating the coolest products out there. Driverless cars, all of these will come from when these two, when technology meets business models and these two meet consumer engagement. That's where a lot of new things are coming in. Bill, do you want to take?
Sure. I'll go right behind here. So I'm just going to spend a few minutes on artificial intelligence and bring Balaji back up again. Artificial intelligence, oftentimes known as cognitive technologies, and those are things like everything from facial recognition to voice recognition to a lot of things that machines essentially can do and process very quickly. Now, a famous study from the University of Oxford says that 47% of total US employment is at risk due to the automation of cognitive tasks. And a lot of economists and a lot of technologists are arguing about whether we will face a world in the very near future where we end up 25-30% kind of permanent under unemployment based on cognitive technologies. Now, not all computer scientists and others believe that that's the case. John Searle, who is from UC Berkeley, he says a computer may appear to understand, but actually it doesn't really understand. And a lot of computer scientists think it's a lot further away in terms of actually being able to automate a lot of these tasks. So a really big argument back and forth. So what do you think about this? Well, let's look at one interesting example.
Yeah. Old school. Okay. Yeah.
Election.
Never said this on TV. Chicks dig me for 200, please.
Kathleen Kenyon's excavation of this city mentioned in Joshua.
I will give you a walkover.
Repaired 17 times.
Can you hear this?
Watson.
No.
What is Jericho? Correct.
Okay.
400 same
so what we are watching
this
essentially,
author,
of course, is the famous Jeopardy episode with Ken Jennings, who is the best
Watson.
Jeopardy player of all time, playing against
category,
the Watson computer.
At the Old Divide Gorge
and
in 1989,
what was interesting about that is that,
Hubby Lewis,
you know, when they decided to do this, beforehand, this was one of the hardest cognitive sort of
skull.
Things that they'd ever
Watson.
Try to do with their computer. And what you're seeing here
right.
is that basically Watson is just kicking butt over Ken Jennings. Every single answer he's getting it before
Watson.
Him. And Balaji is going to talk a little bit about just how difficult this is, what they actually did there. But I was at an event a couple years ago where Ken Jennings was there and also the IBM engineers who put together Watson. Now, the interesting thing about this was that Watson was so big that they couldn't move it to the Jeopardy studio, so they had to actually have the show up in the IBM headquarters, okay, in Armagh. So imagine he's there, you've got Ken Jennings, and in the audience is all the engineers who essentially put together Watson. And this is how Jennings described it.
He was playing in front of a crowd that wanted to see blood. It was an away game for humanity. So anyway, that's the little story. But I just want to emphasize, and Paul will say more, what they were able to do here, the complexity and everything from a technology standpoint of doing this compared to chess, when we saw before, is exponentially harder. It took them a number of years. And the interesting thing that a lot of people don't know is that it was actually watching Jeopardy that inspired one of the, then the CEO of IBM to actually embark on this, because he saw how much attention it got in a bar, and he said, let's try to build a computer that can actually play and win at Jeopardy.
Yeah, it's interesting. I'll take you through what they did a little bit, but I think one thing that you guys must know is you can use Watson right now if you want. You can go on to IBM Watson's page. You can become a subscriber, like get a trial license, put in, let's say, a download of all of your credit card statements on it, and ask questions. You can do this right now. And that's the advantage of these technology spaces is, you know, it looks as though this is meant to solve the problems of the world, but the way they actually came up with it after a period of time of experimenting is they actually threw the beta product, which is not ready, out there for people to experiment on. So you can go become a trial user, feed it a bunch of data, and see how it works. It's actually fascinating the types of little experiments people have done. A lot of people have done dating experiments on it, you know, wrote down all the dates that they've been on, what they've categorized each of these dates, outcomes of those dates, and asked Watson, what is my ideal profile? It's these types of things that Watson is really good at, because even to get to this answer, compared to chess, I think I'm missing a slide in the middle. It is not that Watson was given a data set to say, these are the million questions that somebody can get asked on Jeopardy. Basically, it has access to all of Wikipedia, and it basically looked at whenever you ask a question, it is looking at reading the data in that fractional second and giving you an answer. Versus earlier, it was all about you need a data set, a defined data set, and then you can ask questions. But Watson now learns how is data organized, what is the data structure, and you know the flip side to how Jeopardy works is you give an answer, and then you have to frame a question around it. And then they also figured out a way to do a mechanical thumb that you still have to press the button so that you're actually really competing versus it becoming a software little signal. So they had to figure out all of those and then ability to ask questions in a natural language versus in a code. And that's where all of these artificial intelligence technologies are coming closer to people, because people don't talk in code. People talk in people. So you can ask questions in normal language and it'll respond to you in normal language. And then you can say, okay, what about that? I want the next question to that. And you'll get an answer to that. So that's what is driving the biggest changes in artificial intelligence right now. It's just the proximity of it. This is an interesting case study. So Facebook started working, as you can see, Facebook creates a software that matches, and faintly you can see it's March 2014. It's about a year and a half that they started working on it. And they announced that this is coming close to fruition about 6 months back. And I was reading it just as a general interest. It really hit home when over the weekend we were cooking. And of course, my fiance being my fiance wanted me to take a picture of her to post on Facebook. So I take a picture of her and immediately Facebook brings up a little alert that says, do you want me to tag Meg in the picture and post on Facebook? So it already picked up from my camera the fact that I took a picture, that it is her, and then it's saying post it on Facebook. So it takes a very complex deep learning technology and makes it so close and easy for you to interact with. And imagine this deep learning software using in crime prevention. You know, there are hundreds of approaches that you can use that deep learning that is, of course, not meant for somebody who's cooking Indian food. So, but it's that proximity. And again, now the good thing about it is when that feature is available to a billion people who use Facebook, who are now, when it pops up that image and it says, no, that's not Meg, or yes, that's Meg, and I tag it, the feedback is reinforced, the algorithm is reinforcing itself, versus somebody sitting in a lab and creating artificial data sets and formulate to improve the algorithm. Now there are a billion people who are improving the algorithm. And that's the exponential change. That is when those interactions, billions of interactions, is what's driving change. I'm sure the amount of pictures that are posted on Facebook right now is ridiculous. A lot of them should not be posted, but hopefully soon we'll figure that one out as well. Applications, and you know, there are sensors and Internet of Things has been talked about a lot. City governments have been using Internet of Things a lot to understand what's happening in traffic patterns, to weather patterns, to potholes. City of Boston actually has an application called the pothole app that you install on your phone and you keep driving, and whenever it feels the jolt, it makes a little note. Now imagine 100,000 people have downloaded that app and are using it. The city can now make a pothole map with absolutely zero effort. Typically, it would have taken an army of people driving around, scanning the roads, and city workers getting that feedback back. Now you use citizens to be the sensors, and their phones to be the sensors. And it's not even as though the citizens are actually driving around taking pictures. It's all active. It's all completely no interference required. The smartphone automatically picks it up that there was a sudden jolt with the accelerometer and the gyrometer that are already on the phone, and it creates a map.
And as another example, in a city in Colombia, they had such a problem with the roads, and the city wasn't doing anything, that the local, actually, news media company, what they actually did was they put sensors in all of the potholes in the city. And then whenever someone would drive over them and everything, they would actually, the sensors themselves, the potholes, would tweet out to the mayor as a way of getting attention to it. So, talking potholes in our future.
And you know, the reason why that's possible? Because the cost of sensors has gone down so much. Because the cost, primarily the sensor is a chip. And the cost of the chip is now, the marginal cost of a chip is negligible. You can get chips for 10 cents now. So 5 years back, $100. So that again is social media, cost of computing coming together and providing an input which was never possible before. So this is what convergence of exponentials is. Ingestible sensors. There's a company called Proteus that just signed on with a bunch of health systems where, you know, it's specifically for heart patients that are not adherent to medicine. And they've tried all kinds of techniques to figure out these guys, whether they're taking medicine or not, and how do we give them quick feedback that something's going wrong. So these are little, the green little, they should change the color probably. You actually ingest them, they're the size of a grain. They actually go sit in your stomach, and whenever people, the patient takes pills and drugs, it actually alerts the physician that the adherence actually happened. Because one of the big problems is you can give them pill counters, pill boxes, they just don't click on it. They just don't count it. So it has to become, again, completely interaction-free. So it goes, sits in your stomach, and it constantly is measuring what's happening in your body. And this is actually happening right now. There are not even tests. It's an FDA-approved product. It's in the market right now, and a lot of health systems are using it to drive adherence, drive very different type of patient therapies that never existed before. And this is just the tip of the iceberg right now. Solar, I think you hear a lot about different types of new energy technologies coming up, and now it's becoming personal. The fact that you can harness a lot more power from a smaller surface area, you can actually use, there was recently a news about a scientist created, in a university created, a transparent film that you can put on your windows that acts as a solar generator. So now imagine, that's an eyesore. So the reason why adoption of solar sensors, again, is usually restricted to the roofs is because it does look a little ugly. Now think about if you can actually put a thin layer a transparent layer of a film on top of a window, and that becomes your solar generator, you can put it on any window. And that, again, these types of technologies that make it very easy for people to use, Exponentials is what will change the adoption of it, the usage of it, and the cost of it lower, which, again, is a cycle. I think last slide, I'm gonna give it back to Bill after this, is there's a company in Silicon Valley called Palantir. It's, again, it was started by the co-founder of PayPal, extremely popular company, got a lot of its notoriety because nobody ever confirmed it, like the media reports. They were the primary driver behind capturing bin Laden, using software and technology to connect the dots as to what's going on around the world, to pinpointing that's where he is. And that's when, you know, they got a lot of notoriety. But they work with a lot of city governments to large companies to connect very disparate data sets and come up and identify correlations that are typically unimaginable to come up with. So they are used heavily in crime prevention, all the way to Hershey's. The chocolate company uses them to find correlations between weather patterns and chocolate consumption, which, if they asked me, I would have told them. You know, when it is gloomy, I tend to eat more chocolate. But, you know, if they wanted a high-level data validation for that, they use companies like Palantir. So as you can see, I think whether this is mind-blowing or not, these are things that are happening around, as of now, today, that are touching you every day. One statement that somebody said, it's the future's not far away. It's already here, but it's just distributed unevenly. You use a lot of these technologies today, and it's an ability for you to reflect to see which ones can you apply it to your agency and to your job every day so that we can all serve the citizens better. Bill?
Why don't we see any questions, comments for Balaji before I talk about implications for government?
And just surprising reflections of how you've interacted with technology and they surprise the heck out of you, like my fiance's kitchen story. Go ahead. I think governments are becoming much more proactive in.
Yeah.
No, it's the question of, you know, with all these technologies, what about security? You know, everything from cybersecurity to ability for, you know, any of the hackers to get this data to, you know, there's security perspectives. Anytime you talk about digital, there are security questions. Do you want to take that, Bill?
So my next book is on the digital transformation of government, and. So I did spend a lot of time looking at cybersecurity and that, and it's the way you have to think about it, I think, is important in that the typical model had always been, we're going to build this kind of moat or the big wall around something. As we know through, you know, the history of warfare, people find a way to get over the wall or through the wall or through the moat. And so it's actually looking at it in a very different way, almost like less like that and more like a chess match, where you know people are going to get in. They absolutely are going to get in at some point. But what you want to do is you want to throw out so many decoys and all sorts of things like that. That you know, they're actually called like honeypots and everything. What you're doing is that you want to make it as difficult as possible for the cyber attackers so that they're going to go somewhere else. And you also want to be resilient. So if they do come in, you have a way of quickly finding that out and then changing them. Because one of the things we found with some of the big data breaches, if you followed the one with Office of Personnel Management at the federal level, well, they didn't actually notice that for like 6 months, okay? And one of the big problems why we see those data breaches and so forth, people don't notice them, is that governments don't always have a great inventory of all of their systems, being able to actually understand that. So, I think the cyber issue is one that it's gonna get harder and harder, because what's happening is that while the abilities for governments to actually do cybersecurity are increasing and there's a lot more funding, the criminals are getting better and better and better.
There's a guy, Mark Goodman, who's down at Singularity University, has written a book called Future Crimes. And it's an amazing book because what it actually goes through is that for every sort of malware you can get, for every sort of kind of cybercrime, there's actually a full marketplace for all of that on the dark web. And there are companies who literally just specialize in customer service for the malware. Okay, making sure, so you can call one, like, you know, the equivalent of 1-800 numbers for this. There are these massively open online courses, MOOCs, for cyber criminals, because they just don't pick that all up. So think of it this way, a giant multi-billion dollar marketplace and a whole other world around cyber crime that's going on out there. So it's going to be a little bit like the nuclear arms race and so forth, where deterrent and everything, it's going to be around with us for a long time, but we are living in a digital era, and so you can't just say we're going to put everything in, you know, in paper and remove it. And it's just one of those things that governments have to get better and better and better and really focused on this all the way from a, I think, chief executive gubernatorial perspective.
Just to add to that, you know, one thing that is also happening is there are also white hackers that have come up. There are services that large companies are using. They call, a few that I can give you names of are SYNAC, S-Y-N-A-C-K, HackerOne. So, you know, governments and large companies are actually using these guys who are actually good to poke and test. So these are called penetration testing, vulnerability testing companies. Use those guys to poke and prod much better, and they work on incentives. They work on bounties. So you find a vulnerability, I pay you for it. So use these guys' creativity in a different way, whereas they take pride in destroying these systems. You can actually take pride in finding that vulnerability and getting paid for it as well. And I think that's another way of approaching cybersecurity and using the same structure of people trying to destroy it, to use the same people to make it better. Sorry, go ahead.
Haven't we really, with Windows 10, taken a silo-based approach? Instead of integrating Cortana into separate entities like antivirus and device controls and as a platform, a underbelly of the how, that would have been a much better solution than having a siloed approach where Cortana, all it does is answer questions and it really doesn't do anything to protect the system as a whole. You know, it could theoretically protect the system as a whole if given the ability to do so, but the way that we took the silo approach, I think that the real problem with that artificial intelligence at this point is that we are implementing it only on a question and answer basis, and that's not how it's supposed to be used. It's supposed to be used integrated into all the systems to integrate a whole functionality like an actual person, and then from that point it can interact, and it could be law enforcement, it could be your help desk on your computer, it could be all these things, but we haven't taken it to that level. We're just still in the piddly stages where we're using it to answer questions that are, I mean, who really cares if you, how many thousands of people are in maybe South Africa who have iPhones? You know, I mean, that question might be relevant to one person, but it's not relevant to
them. Yeah, so I think we don't want to get into commenting on individual pieces of software and configurations and everything, but I would say a few things. I mean, and then we'll move on past cybersecurity because there's other sessions here on that. The biggest problem tends to be very, very simple, is that the first thing you want to do is lock the doors. It's like, and you know what? A lot of times the doors are unlocked, and it's not necessarily always the fault of the CIO or the CSO. What it is individual employees are unlocking those doors all the time, and they're doing it because someone, it may be an administrator, and they are playing World of Warcraft or something, and then an email comes in saying, oh, here's another download. It's actually malware. And so that's what's at the very basic thing is doing that, and you're going to eliminate a lot of the problems that we've seen. The last thing I would say is that I think around artificial intelligence, We're still at a pretty early stages in most mission areas in government. We are seeing examples, but I mean, in policing, I do think that that's an area that's moving forward. But the city of Los Angeles right now is considered a leader in the country in terms of predictive policing. Now, for some people, that gets a little bit scary towards Minority Report and pre-crime and so forth. The Chicago Police Department will actually say that they, using various Twitter feeds and a lot of stuff like that, that they've predicted a different, you know, serious violent crimes a number of times before, and they just couldn't get there fast enough. So I think, you know, you go through a lot of different areas, and we are seeing various elements of artificial intelligence go much beyond just asking those questions. But let's now get into what does this mean for government? What are some big trends that we see? And then we're going to get into this interactive exercise where we essentially would like all of you then to participate in this exercise. So the seven faces of tomorrow's government. What does it look like? What are some big trends that we see? So we've developed what I think is the biggest website in the world, the deepest looking at the future government, called Gov 2020. You can go on there. There's 50 drivers of change, and there's over 250 trends that we've seen from policing to healthcare to what have you. It's all open. And there's, it's done in a way that makes it very easy, almost like an advent calendar, where you can open up a thing, you can see case studies and samples, you can move on to another area. So we spent years researching that. There's 15 videos on the future of government there, and I encourage you to check it out. So the first thing is, we've heard a lot about artificial intelligence, cognitive technology. What we wanted to explore was this: what would a government look like a cognitive government? Can we foresee something like that? And cognitive is all about what makes computers cognitive and technologists is when they learn from interactions and they get better and better, as biology was saying about the algorithms. So this would be a government that learns from the interactions with data and with humans. Like, that's that convergence that we're going to keep on seeing between those two, and is continually reconfiguring in the pursuit of better outcomes. Now, why this is important is because in an age of exponential change and innovation and so forth, if you have government not changing very much, it's going to fall not only further and further behind, but it's going to be very dangerous in every respect. And if we look at over history, we haven't tended to see periods of time where government has been 10 or 20, 30, 40 years ever behind the private sector in technology. It's usually a little bit of a lag, but it starts moving in that direction. So we see three major elements. You have open functionality, you have applied learning, where continuous learning, and then adaptive rules. Let's look at those one by one. Open functionality is a really key element, and that basically means within any organization, there's always going to be more smart people outside of it than inside of it, just because there are more people. And that's kind of one of the key elements of Silicon Valley and how they get along. Now, governments are starting to open up and trying to get ideas from the private sector, from social enterprises, from nonprofits, and say, here are some of our biggest challenges. How can you help us to solve them? The Obama administration has been at the kind of forefront of a lot of this. They've done over 600 prizes and challenges over the last 7 years, where they basically said, say NASA itself has done 80 of these, where they basically said, we have this big problem in space, and help us, we asked the world to actually help us solve this. And the prizes are everything from a couple $1,000s to $25 million. And some of you may have heard of the X Prize, which we're associated with. That's a piece of it. But more and more, we're seeing that happening. Cities all over the country are opening up in this way, and they're opening up essentially just saying, how do we get all that innovation going on in the private sector and bring it in to help us solve public problems? That's what my last book was about. And you have here in California some of the most innovation anywhere in the world. And one of the problems, I will say, is that not enough of that innovation comes into government, and not enough of it is applied to solving some of these big public and societal problems we have here in California. And that can change. Let me give you an example that I think of the right direction for this. So the city of San Francisco wants to be the world capital for the Internet of Things. And there's a lot of startups doing stuff like that. And they say, you know, we have a good opportunity to then make this happen from an economic development standpoint by using the city as a sandbox, in a way, for the Internet of Things as they're trying things out. And we don't even have to pay them because there's so many companies that want to have use cases. So what they've done is they have something called kind of startups in residence. They take applications and the mayor just put one out 2 days ago. They take applications for the best ideas around different technologies, let's say Internet of Things here. And in the last round, there's like 250 companies and startups that put in applications, and the top seven then would get to work with individual agencies on use cases over a course of 8 weeks. And they would be kind of in residence working together with the government. One of them was like doing Internet of Things in the airports. So you would have much better kind of geospatial thing. Imagine Google Maps and Waze, but within an airport, right? And understanding that. So the city is bringing in all these great ideas and trying and prototyping and testing all these things, and it's not actually costing them anything. And so what is it worth it for the private sector? It's actually having use cases that they can take to other cities. So I think that's a great idea of looking at who's in our broader ecosystem and how can we use that ecosystem and apply it to solve problems. Another thing is applied learning, and this is all around prototyping, agile development, sense and respond. The big problem right now when you look at public policy and so forth is that we spend years and years kind of doing a bill and doing the legislation and then all the policy analysis, and then it gets passed and we cross our fingers hoping it's going to work in the real world, right? Well, it doesn't work like that in the private sector. They're testing, prototyping, testing. I used to live in California. I'm seventh generation California, but I was living here after electricity deregulation that happened. How many of you remember what happened after that, right? It was passed 96-0. Nothing in the California legislature gets passed 96-0 very much. It went through. Everyone thought this was going to be really wonderful. But they did the legislation in a way so it would get passed. But what they hadn't done was war game all the different ways that someone might game it. And it was so complicated that even the regulators didn't quite understand it. But there was a group of really smart engineers who actually figured this out. Who was that? Enron. They didn't make it Enron proof. And what happened was, year and a half after this went into effect, we had blackouts, right, in the state. It felt like a third world country. It was crazy. And why? Because they designed that legislation not for execution to work in the real world, but to get past the legislature. And if you look at so many failures, big failures, it's the design stage, and then they pass it over to all of you and say, okay, do something with it. And then when it goes wrong, they blame it on you instead of the legislative staff. It's a very big pet peeve of mine. We need to have a different model. And a different model, which is much more about prototyping, testing with real people in the real world. And the state of California you're going to be doing technology differently. You're moving towards an agile approach, user-based design, and a lot of stuff. And that's what that's all about. Balaji, you had a good example of this. Do you want to mention that?
Yeah, I think as Deloitte is a large company, we have very similar problems just as well. You know, our clients have very similar problems, which is, instead of spending months sitting and doing strategy and then build one application, is there a better way to prototype and wireframe multiple applications, do rapid testing in the marketplace, and then build something that you know is going to work versus expecting slides to convert into apps, into applications very easily? So we now work with a bunch of crowdsourcing vendors who help us. We can get to a mock-up of an application that needs to be built out in about a week, working with a crowd. And then the benefit of working with a crowd is, for that application, you get 25 different options. So you get to learn from how different people might attack that problem differently, and then you come up and then you decide based on what you really see versus what you think you might see. And then there are other applications, other vendors out there, crowdsourcing vendors, that you can actually take it to your cohort of people, that these are the types of people that I'd use it, and they would actually test it out again in a day or two, and then they come back with copious amount of feedback saying, this is what is working, this is not what is working,
the messages that you're communicating are getting lost, and you've taken 2 weeks in that process.
And I'll give you an example.
And not 4 months.
Of how that works, but thank you.
So that's a kind of a very key element to happen. And lastly, it's just adaptive rules. That's basically when things are moving very quickly and the regulatory structure and the procurement structure and personnel is stuck in a different century, there's a huge mismatch. And so one of the good examples we've looked at here is what you've done kind of around both sharing economy and Uber and so forth, and now autonomous vehicles. Like the state of California around some of these technology areas is taking a leading role actually putting together some of that legislative and that other framework that's more adaptive than we've seen elsewhere. Solution recruiter, this is similar. It's kind of governments as part of solution ecosystems where there's a lot of innovation out there, a lot of people trying to solve problems. There's big foundations like the Gates Foundation, the Robert Wood Johnson, and governments linking up with those organizations and saying what we're going to do is try to recruit solutions rather than develop them all in-house. You've got a lot of organizations doing that. If you look in the federal government, there's organizations like DARPA, which is the organization that actually then helped develop the internet in the first place. And what they do is they look at what are some of the things, the problems we're seeing from a defense, and how do we get them solved? And then they go out to the world to help solve them. There's a group that was part of the UK government called Big Society Capital. And they basically were financed in a way from the government. And their goal is to create a market for social outcomes. Let's say we want to reduce recidivism. So we're going to create a market among nonprofits, social enterprises, and others to try to get others to figure out the answer to those problems. So we're moving in this direction pretty rapidly. A lot is happening at the federal government in the cities. And another example of this, which builds on what Balaji said. So as we look at the solar issue right now, the cost of solar has gone way down, right, in terms of the panels. But one of the problems with solar is that what's called the soft cost or the plug-in cost, like customer acquisition and retention and all of those things, are still really high. They're at 40%, and most industries are down towards 8%. The Department of Energy said, you know, until we get that down a lot more, solar's going to be stalled, and so it's not going to grow as fast. Eventually, the marketplace may figure this out, but we want to accelerate that. So they did this really interesting thing. They said, we're going to have a contest. We're going to give some money out to it. They, at the first stage of it, what they wanted to do is people to develop apps that consumers and businesses and others could use to actually reduce those costs and make it easier, just to make it easier to get solar and so forth. They got 140 business case. They shortlisted to 17 different organizations. And then what they did was really brilliant. They said, okay, we want to see all of you have a chance to build out your ideas. We're going to give each of you $25,000 in credit from Top Coder. Top Coder is a group that we work with, and what it is, it's a network of 750,000 developers who compete, essentially, to build different elements of a technology application. And sometimes it might only be $5,000 for this one, $5,000, $10,000. And through that sort of a process, they were able to get these prototypes built in 5 weeks. Now think about that. And then they each got this, it was really, really amazing. So they involved both a contest and a challenge with crowdsourcing, and they put it together to facilitate a marketplace. More and more governments are moving in this direction, radically different than anything we would have seen just a decade ago. And there's a variety of other ways to engage the broader ecosystem, prizes and challenges, hackathons, and so forth. Just-in-time civil service. So what about the people element? We just did a big data analysis of millennials and government. Okay, what we wanted to actually say is we hear all these things about millennials that, number one, they don't want to work for government, that they're going to leave right away for the private sector, that they don't have the passion for public service and so forth. They want to all work in, you know, nonprofits or so forth. What we wanted to see was, what does the data actually say? Okay? What does the data say as opposed to all these anecdotes we hear? So what does the data actually say? Anyone want to guess about millennials? Who said that? Yes. You're right. So all the anecdotes are mostly based on myths. So it turns out that the turnover rate for millennials is no different than previous generations in terms of government, that the ability to bring them in isn't any different. And you go through all of this, it just, they're starting later because of the recession and because governments have not been hiring for the most part. So millennials are 20% or so of the overall workforce, but in the federal government, they're like 7%. Why? Because the federal government wasn't hiring for years. And then they weren't hiring millennials. So that's the big problem. But still, millennials, what we do know from a lot of data is they don't want to work in the same way. They don't want to work in one agency or something for 30, 35 years. They want to have a variety of experiences. And it could be all within government, but across government. And that's the beauty. So we talk about just-in-time civil service. Civil service and everything is a big issue here. And your sponsor of this conference, Mary Bell, is very, very passionate about this, as you may know. And I do think the current system is just not working for it. It's not set up for the kind of world we live in now. But we are seeing a lot of interesting examples. So at the federal level, we have presidential innovation fellows. They're on two-year stints, essentially. They bring them in from the private sector. They go and work on really important projects. And then sometimes they'll get to stay, but they don't have to go through all sorts of things. And it's a contest and a challenge to get the best and brightest. And then they created something based on that called 18F. After healthcare.gov and all those problems there, president said, you know what? I want to get the best and brightest technologists from Silicon Valley and around the country to work and help solve these problems in government we have with technology projects. So they created something called 18F in the US Digital Service. And you're going to hear, I think, a little bit more about that today. And basically, they've been able to then bring in about 150 top technologists. And no, what 18F folks do is they don't work in just the Department of Transportation or something. It's more like a consulting sort of thing. So they'll go and work on projects in all these different agencies. They might be there for 4 months, they might be there for 6 months, and then they'll work in another one. But they have expertise in certain areas, like user experience, user design, service architect, web developer. And they love the fact that they get to try these challenges across, horizontally across government. We came up with a model called GovCloud, which is a model for doing it that way 4 years ago, and then you kind of push and prod, governments do it. Well, finally, they've adopted this at the federal level with 18F and also adopted it in Canada and a few other countries. So think about more of the workforce horizontal as opposed to vertical. And that's the kind of thing you give younger workers an experience working across different government agencies with their expertise. The other thing 18F did was they hacked hiring. They said, you know what, we can't get the best and brightest if it takes 6 to 9 months to actually hire someone because the private sector will steal them away like that. They got it all the way down to 6 to 8 weeks using existing rules and so forth. And then what they did is they said, we hacked the hiring process as in fixing it. And there's a number of forces that are involved there. So I'm going to just do this last one here. Actually, I'm going to skip this because we're running out of time. And I want to get to what I think is a really important area, which is the digital transformation of government, which is probably the biggest challenge for governments today and probably the most important thing you are all entering. So we did a big survey, 1,200 government officials in 70 countries, where we asked them about this this last year. And this is what you all told us. This is the 96% say the digital is impacting your domain. 76% is disrupting the public sector. So almost everyone agrees. Very, very important. But then we also asked, how ready are you for it? 76% of government officials said that they believe that they're behind the private sector and very concerned about that. So then we wanted to unpack, well, what's really going on? Why is this happening? And it turns out that there's one really important thing here. 76% see digital as a big, or 82% as a big opportunity, yet only 46% have a coherent digital strategy, and only 44% have increased investment. So you've got this big discrepancy between belief it's important, and yes, transformational, and all that, and yet what's actually happening there on the one hand. So that's the gap that needs to be closed. The one thing I want to leave you with, lastly, to how to think about digital in your agencies. Well, first of all, Digital is a radically different process. It's usually not done in a waterfall way. It's done through Agile, and it's done through a lot of user focus. But depending on what your services are is going to depend on how you go about digital. So there are two essentially different ways most agencies are. What you do is either inherently digital, which means it can easily be turned into bits and bytes, and that's anything to do with kind of paperwork processes, paperwork factories. So if you are the state franchise board, all of that's inherently digital. At the federal level, the Census Bureau, inherently digital. And all those areas, and government does a lot of that, okay? A lot of that paperwork and forms, all of that within the next few years should be 100% digital, 100%. And people are going to say, well, what about the digital divide and so forth and so on? What we find is that the overwhelming majority of people who are on assistance and so forth actually have smartphones, and they prefer to interact with government through those phones. We've been doing a lot of work, like literally going into service centers and working with them. So if you're in that sort of an area, your big challenge is how to get to 100% digital from where you are today, and that changes things dramatically. So what about if you're the department, you're Caltrans, or you are the police departments, or what you're doing is inherently physical. Transportation, law and order, public health, then you say, well, what does digital mean for me? Well, what it actually means is that inherently physical, we're going to see these digital overlays over it, and that kind of connection, physical and digital systems. So if you look at transportation, as Balaji says, even before autonomous vehicles, it's becoming a lot more about digital. Departments of transportation are going to need to move from being just builders to actually figuring out how to get people from one place to the another using mobility. And so that becomes very, very digital. Incarceration and prisons and so forth. So much of what we see around crime fighting is becoming digital. But you can imagine you had a huge prisoner overcrowding problem. Well, you can imagine now in a world where for nonviolent offenders, that you use electronic monitoring and mobile devices, and you can ring fence people and so forth like that. And we already do that for literally hundreds of thousands of people, and the cost is about 90% less. And you're figuring out those systems. I think over time, we're gonna see less and less nonviolent offenders in actually prisons. And we're gonna use these digital systems. And then you've got connected healthcare. Healthcare is, again, something that's becoming, it's going to be, you know, much, much more about these sort of digital overlays and sensors and other stuff around us. Okay, so now let's get to the thing that we're going to do here. So you've heard a lot about these different technologies, and what we'd like you to do is like to explore in groups what you think this means for California government. And what you're going to see is we're going to ask you to go to the different boards and just probably 8 to 10 people per board, and then divvy out these cards, which are going to have a lot of these technologies and a lot of these societal changes on them. And then you're going to look at the cards. Maybe each person gets 2 cards or so, 3 cards. And you're going to put it on up there on the boards in terms of within this quadrant. Is it from most likely to least likely, least disruptive to most disruptive? And then we're going to put them on. And then after you've put the cards up individually, we want you as a group to discuss it, to discuss a little bit of, yes, move things around a little bit. And what the goal is to get to what are the 1 or 2 big drivers and these big trends that you think are going to be the most likely and the most disruptive for California government. And it could be within your individual agencies or writ large. And then what we're going to do is we're going to have a short little minute. Each one's going to kind of do a report out about what you decided on and how you decided. Does that make sense? Any questions on that? Yes. What?
An example.
An example? Yeah. OK, so an example on one of these cards might be Internet of Things. Okay, so the Internet of Things being something, and then you would say, well, how likely is the Internet of Things to play a big role in California government, whether it's in energy? And in each card, it'll have a description and, and so forth, so you get to know more about it. And you might say, well, I think the Internet of Things is going to be very likely, or maybe like here, and probably this amount of disruptive. And so I'm going to put it here. And then another example may be climate change is one of those. And you say, well, I think that's really likely and very disruptive, but maybe it's happening too far out. So that's kind of what you're doing. And you're just like going to be putting these around this. And this will give us all a sense as a group what we see as some of like the most powerful potential drivers of change for California government over the next 5 to 10 years. Does that make sense? So instead of giving you numbers, we're going to just ask you to kind of move over to these as a group, and we'll have people helping to facilitate, and just find some places on the wall that are a little bit empty. If you need to move the chairs around a little bit, and then we're going to give you about 15 minutes, 10, 15 minutes to actually do this exercise, and then we're going to come back together. And we do have, there's a double-sided tape down below that you're going to be able to use to tape them up. Yes. Okay, so let's one more minute, and then we're going to have you guys, we're going to go one by one. We're going to ask you to talk about the most disruptive and then least. One or two examples from each. And pick who's going to brief out. Okay. I think we're gonna go with whatever you're at right now. Who wants to start? We're gonna start over. Okay. We're gonna go back and forth. Let's start with this group right here. So give us your, and each one, no more than a minute on this. Most disruptive, most likely, and then maybe example or two, least likely, least disruptive, and why? Michael.
Yes, thank you. So we kind of, we picked radical openness. We're kind of thinking transparency and open data. But we think it really pairs well with analytics, because yeah, the more that you have that data out there, and then you have the analytics to derive knowledge from that data, when you talk about government, what is the most influential factor that changes government? And that's the voters. So if the voters can get the proper information out, to them from the government, government has tons of data that's completely underutilized. But if you can get it out there, you can get it analyzed, and you can get informed voters, you're going to totally change government, hopefully.
Great. Okay. And you had rising income inequality, least likely and least disruptive. Explain that.
Well, so I'll go to mega cities. the other one's kind of loaded. The mega cities we went to was I've been told I look like one, but no, I'm not. So mega cities, with all the technology out there, it seems like the concentration of resources in a mega city is less important these days. Is kind of what we were, thinking about. You're able to kind of, Amazon drones fly to your house, and you don't have to be all that. You get second day shipping, so you don't really have to go out and leave your area. Work from home, telework, and stuff like that. So that's kind of where we went there.
Very good. Okay, thank you so much. Nice job to this group.
I should say, I think that's a great answer. So guess how many open government data sets there are in the world today? There's an organization that tracks it. Anyone want to guess? There's over a million today. And so we're working with MIT Media Lab, and we will release in about 2 months something called Data USA, which will be the biggest data visualization of all the economic and education and everything statistics in the US that exist. There'll be over 20 million data visualizations there. And it's all built off open government data, and just to help everyone from high school students to government economic development departments. Let's go to this group right here, which has a very full, and you can only go through two, okay? And I think nothing is least disruptive or least likely right now.
Everything, whether whether it's something that is social, demographic, technology, everything that we read here, we kind of had distributed them initially, but as you read each one to see where it needed to go, everything was likely because it's already happening, and everything was creates a disruption to some to the government, to the community, to society, whoever it is. It creates some
which
sense of
disruption.
Which
number one in your list?
Well, everything couldn't fit over here.
Okay.
So okay. It's not that they're all varying degrees. It's just that they all belong in this cluster. One of the ones that I had actually put here under economic was the infrastructure bottlenecks. It's the infrastructure takes so long for the government to do anything about, and it's totally disruptive to the government and to the public, and it's not just likely, it's happening, just like everything else here.
Well, great. Thank you so much. And what's interesting about that is because it is taking so long, by the time government gets around to it, it'll look very different because it will have autonomous vehicles and you need 30% less concrete and a totally different sort of actually physical infrastructure for autonomous, if you think about it. So that's something that all transportation departments have to contend with now. Let's go to this group, and Roy is going to be the speaker. Roy.
Thanks, Will. I got voluntold to be the speaker. So I think from our perspective, we looked at all these trends, and the summary is none of them felt like they weren't going to happen, so all of them were in the high likelihood or most likely, so that's why it's all in the kind of upper top half here. And then when we looked at whether it's least disruptive versus most disruptive, with every trend we said, are some of these things happening today already, and some of us have not even known about it? We've just absorbed it. It's part of the end user experience. We haven't felt like it's been disruptive. So those are the things on the left side. So for example, money sharing applications or sensors from an Internet of Things perspective, where it hasn't truly disrupted our way of life. It's only made it easier and more convenient, so we felt it was less disruptive, versus some of the things that are most disruptive, like the pills that you swallow, right? And that was one of our examples, right? That's going to change, or 3D printing of organs. So what happens if an organ is printed and it's a defective printed organ? Who do we sue, or what's the impact to government and policy and providers and healthcare provide, you know, things like that? So I think that could totally disrupt what that trend could do, which is why it's
artificial intelligence, the most disruptive.
It's the most disruptive in terms of the systems and the policies and the procedures from a government perspective to enable that. Your simple example was if a driverless car crashes, is government at fault? So it could truly disrupt the ecosystem. So that was our kind of categorization here.
Thank you. So I ask in all my presentations on Gov 2020, I ask to government officials, I ask, what percentage of government jobs do you think are at risk due to automation and so forth within the next 10 years? And I always get the same band. So I'm going to ask you a show of hands. How many of you think that over 50% of government jobs are at risk due to automation, artificial intelligence? Raise your hand. Okay, we got about a third. 25 to 50%. Okay, a little bit more. Under 25%. Huh? Fairly even. I think it's usually 25 to 50% is what people say. And I'm guessing those of you that say under 25% is you just believe that those jobs won't go away, they'll just maybe be redeployed somewhere else. Let's go to Erica and your group. What is your group's name? Did you have a special name? I know, I'm just putting you on the spot.
I too, like Roy, was voluntold, and unfortunately I was not told to come up with a name. But yeah, we kind of went the same road that these two groups went, as far as a lot of these innovations are already occurring. They're already with us, so we thought a lot of things were most likely. The things that we thought were least likely, were things like on the expanding human potential with the innovations that will help map out or track things going on with the human brain. We thought those would possibly be least likely. Yes, they're happening, but we saw a great deal of pushback from the public, meaning, like we gave one example, like, sure, you can put a sensor on my garbage can to see how often I put it out to the curb to for somebody to collect the garbage, but once you start, you know, picking at my brain, that's a different story. So that's what the least likely ended up being, were things that we thought that we might get public pushback on. Not that government couldn't do it, not that the innovations weren't already occurring, but that the mass adoption of these might be limited. So that's where we went.
Great, great, thank you. And actually, if you look at the area of government where this notion of kind of neuroscience and enhancing mental faculties and so forth is the most advanced right now, is guess where? Is the military. Because the military is trying to create essentially super soldiers right now, who never get tired, who basically are always thinking despite not having slept for all this time, so they're looking at all sorts of technologies and pharmaceuticals and so forth to enable that.
Yes. As opposed to, you know, if somebody hears from Department of Health or something like that, the military has a leg up on doing things like that, doing groundbreaking things, because they're able to do it in a way that you can't do it with the general public.
Exactly. And very controlled
very
population.
Controlled, you can't say no.
Yeah. So let's do one more. Let's do one more group, and then we will call it. What's one other group that just you really want to get your ideas out there? How about this
one or that?
Any volunteers? Okay. The last group, Brendan.
So we had a, we decided that disruptive doesn't mean necessarily negative, it was just change in general in government. And that there was quite a few, as you can see on the bottom half, that we just thought their government was never going to get to. That the experience of the people in the group, which was titled The Exponentials, by the way, was we just felt that there are certain things that were just too far beyond the ability of government to do in anything considered the near future, but that if they did happen, they would create significant impact in the organizations. I didn't know if you wanted me to speak to any specifically.
Speak to one,
yeah. So one that we thought was significant that we will speak to was the rising income inequality. That it is likely to happen, but I thought there was kind of this caveat here that said that even though there will be significant inequality, that the poor do have access to more services. So working with social services personally, the public does have a lot more access to healthcare, to even here in Sacramento, to homelessness services, drug abuse services. California is a really liberal state in that aspect, and gives our public access to a lot of services despite income inequality. And that is happening, and it's happening more and more. The number of claims we get and so on and so forth is always increasing. But that the ability to deliver those services is creating a huge impact for government. The amount of time it takes staff. When Covered California came on board, you know, social services had to ramp up on all sorts of, Department of Health had to ramp up on all sorts of services. Healthcare services had to ramp up on all social services that weren't there before. So the impact of having these kind of programs to help disparate income is causing a huge disruption.
Great point, Brendan. At least my feeling on all this is that we will see a lot of, just we've seen all the way through the last 50 years, a lot of clerical positions and other positions will go away. By the way, 50 years ago when they came up with a lot of the modern civil service system at the federal level, the majority of people working for the federal government were clerks, essentially. And now the overwhelming majority, in many respects, are people with it, either college degrees or even advanced degrees. So it's a whole different sort of workforce. And I think we will see more and more automation of government jobs, but that's going to free up more and more people to the human side of government and working with person to person using technology, because there's a lot of people who need a lot of help, right? And there's not enough people to help them now. So I think we will be seeing a big shift along those lines where you're able to leverage technology. And even, Watson-like systems, I think most people in the field will have access to those within the next 15, earlier than that, 10 years or so. So every time they have to make a decision on something, it's not just based on gut or their only experience, but based on millions and millions of prior times. doing that. So I want to thank you all so much for being here today and for participating in this. I hope you learned a little bit and expanded what you're thinking about. I think the big thing you said is, you know, this is stuff you see already happening all out there, maybe not in huge respects. And so I think to go back to your agencies and just think about what are the implications for what I do? If I'm in the Department of Environment, Cal EPA, what is the implications of Internet of Things and sensors on regulation? If I'm in Caltrans, what's the implications of autonomous vehicles and others on this? And, you know, so that's what's really important. That's what we're trying to get you to do, is just kind of open your mind in that way. So thanks very much, and have a great rest of the conference. Bye now.